Well, in Washington, I'm joined by David Kilcullen, a top counterinsurgency adviser to both the Bush and Obama administrations in Iraq and Afghanistan. From East London, we're joined by the former Labour Security Minister, Admiral Lord West. And in the studio here, Catherine Heseltine, former head of the Muslim Public Affairs Committee, and Robin Simcox from the think tank, the Henry Jackson Society. David Kilcullen, first, where do people like this fit in to the counterterrorism map? Can they be trusted when they say, I'm not a threat?
Well, I think when I look at the extraordinarily large numbers of people from across Europe and Australia and the Americas who've traveled to Syria to take part in this fight, the analogy that strikes me is people leaving similar places actually to fight in Spain against the fascists in the 1930s. Some of those people were motivated by a sense of adventure, by a sense of a humanitarian obligation to a society and a desire to oppose fascism. But then a small number of people have been involved in very, very significant crimes against humanity and in the potential for a terrorist threat against their home societies. And so I think the challenge here is we have to walk a line between, on the one hand, treating everybody automatically as a terrorist and a threat to their parent society, and on the other hand, allowing people to simply come back without any form of rehabilitation or any kind of processing to validate that they, in fact, are not part of that subgroup that we need to be worried about.
Most
countries that are looking at this problem are coming up with similar types of approaches.
I mean, the risk was clearly stated there, was that if you treat them as terrorists and you call them enemies, there is a risk that some will become what you're calling them.
Yeah, and that is true. And there's also the risk that some will do what we just saw in Paris a couple of weeks ago, which is come back under the radar and carry out military-style assaults within their parent societies. And so what the dilemma is for governments is figuring out how to balance those opposite risks. What the dilemma is for young people in our communities who are incensed by what's going on in Syria is to figure out, how do I contribute in a way that helps that humanitarian situation without destroying the rest of my life essentially for nothing, which seems to be the case for the two guys that you just had on.
Admiral West, let me bring you in. What would you do with people like the two young men we've spoken to?
Well, I don't think there's any one size fits all. There have been effectively two waves of people going over to Syria. The first wave were idealists, and as was just said, rather like the volunteers in the war in Spain before the Second World War. And a number of those who've been there have been totally shocked by what they've seen happen. Some of them have come back. Some of them are actually scarred and need psychological help. Others are able to overcome it in the way those two who talked were. But they're very different from the second wave, who've been going out there once it's very clear what ISIL are actually doing. And the danger is some of that first wave, a tiny, tiny, tiny number, might have been radicalized. Of the second wave, that some of those are fairly radical. And what's interesting is ISIL itself, of course, is treating some of the European foreign fighters bad. It's just executed a whole raft of them who wanted to get out. But we can't really take the risk of just letting a free flow coming back in. Not only have we had the attacks in Paris and in Belgium, we've actually stopped some attacks by people coming back. So we do need to be able to check and see who's coming in and somehow to be able to talk to them, maybe treat them psychologically to help them get over the trauma of it, and for some of them to spot, you know, that they might actually be a risk to us.
Robin Simcox, should people like that be arrested?
Well, in that example, if someone's gone for idealistic purpose, holds absolutely no ill will towards the UK and it's assessed as a threat to security, then obviously he's not going to be in the pile of people they're concerned about. But we shouldn't ignore the fact that there is a significant constituency. Think of people like Jihadi John, who beheads people on tape, who are obviously...
So how are you going to tell? I mean, you're all saying there are two types.
Right.
How are you going to pick up
the security services have such a difficult job. And why it's so difficult when you've got returning fighters on top of an already very grave security situation in the UK, that's why it's such a tough job for them.
Catherine Heseltine, a lot of people will be saying, why take the risk? The government was really clear, don't go, they said. You'll be breaking the law, you will be picked up when you return. They ignored the advice, they went. Why not just pick them up?
Unfortunately, what the government's proposals are actually a recipe for creating more terrorism. They're proposing effectively exile by government decree and creating a kind of second-class citizenship for Muslims where you can have your rights as a citizen. Rights that have existed since the Magna Carta, just taken away like that.
But you accept they did, you know, they were all very clearly advised. Ministers, policemen were on these programmes every day saying, do not go to Syria to fight. And they've gone and done that.
And if anyone has committed any crimes, any offences, where there's evidence, people should be prosecuted. Unfortunately, Muslims who criticise the government on this are often labelled as some kind of apologist for terror, which is ridiculous when I don't want myself or anyone getting blown up on a London bus any more than anyone else does. However, my fear is that these kind of draconian measures will only alienate the entire Muslim community, further fuel radicalisation and increase that risk that we all face. Instead, the government is ducking the real issue of tackling the actual root causes of terrorism, i.e. our Western foreign policy that is brutal and extremist in itself.
Robin Simcox, the trouble is the government's position has completely flipped. You know, it's gone from wanting to launch military action against Assad to basically, you know, leaving him in place now.
I mean, the first thing to say, I mean, it obviously isn't Western foreign policy that led to the Assad situation. I mean, this is Assad that carried out these killings. And also, there's also a misconception that our policy at home is especially draconian. Actually, one in five people who've returned from Syria and Iraq so far have even been prosecuted. So the vast majority of people, the government hasn't chosen to prosecute.
Well, we don't know whether they didn't choose or whether they just didn't know.
At least they just got back in, nobody knows. And this is a problem. It's a problem we've had going back to Afghanistan, Bosnia, Iraq. We've always had great difficulty in prosecuting people who fought in foreign conflict zones.
Lord West, I mean, you know, what about the government's position here? And they've sent very confusing signals, haven't they, to people who were appalled by the humanitarian situation in Syria. One minute, the Prime Minister wants to intervene and say this is terrible. Now, you know, I mean, reading between the lines, it's as though British policy is effectively saying Assad's the best bet.
I wouldn't quite put it in those terms, but there's no doubt that over a period of a couple of years, things do change. ISIL, without a doubt, are a very real and present and deadly danger to that entire region. They have to be the prime focus of everything we do. Sadly, within Syria, there are a number of groups, and the democratic group are actually now really quite weak. It's rather like Churchill in the war saying he was happy to have tea with the devil himself. This was when the Soviet Union came in to defeat Hitler. You have to focus on your prime enemy, then you can think about exactly how you're going to deal with others. And that makes the dealing with Assad very, very difficult, but we still are very clear that he's a dictator who we'd like to be rid of, and we would like the demographic group opposing him in power.
Catherine Heseltine, I mean, those men were very clear about what they felt their responsibilities were to the people of Syria. What do you think their responsibility is to the people of Britain, now they're back?
To live their lives as citizens, like they were stating they are. And, you know, I think We should see people like that who care about human rights as sharing those British values that Cameron loves to lecture the Muslim community on.
But if they are as appalled by Islamic State as they are by Assad, should they share intelligence? Should they collaborate with the authorities in any way? Or, you know, what do you think their responsibility is?
Where we see, you know, terrible acts of brutality, like the execution of humanitarian workers by ISIS. No one is pretending ISIS are not an extremist, brutal group of people. However, the British government is cosy with extreme and brutal regimes like the Saudi government. We see the huge double standards with British Jews going out to fight for Israel in the assault on Gaza that bombed schools and hospitals and killed 400 Muslim children there. These kind of double standards are what is driving the alienation and radicalisation that puts us all at risk from terrorism.
Well, some of those thoughts on Saudi Arabia we'll be picking up in just a few minutes. For now, thank you all very much indeed for joining us. Kathy.